although I want to be very clear, we're not sending combat troops into Iraq.
President Obama defending his decision to start a more robust program to back the moderate rebels in Syria. Let's bring in our panel. Steve Hayes of the Weekly Standard, A.B. Stoddard from The Hill, and syndicated columnist Charles Krauthammer. So, President Obama has finally decided to ask Congress for $500 million to train and to arm the Syrian rebels, but first they have to vet the rebels to make sure it's the good rebels, not the bad rebels. They got to figure out what the program is, and they got to find a place for this to happen. And Steve, some administration officials are saying this may not start till next year.
Yeah, I mean, this is the kind of aid that could have made, could have had a real impact had it taken place 18 months ago, when you had a Free Syrian Army that was largely secular, fairly moderate, and was taking on the Assad regime. What happened in the interim is that the Free Syrian Army and its generals turned increasingly to jihadists to help it basically survive and fight against the Assad regime. The jihadists grew in number, grew in ferocity, and now, rather than having a few clusters of jihadists joining a relatively moderate group of Free Syrian Army fighters, you have ISIS in something that closely resembles an army taking massive swaths of territory in both Syria and Iraq. So it may be easier to distinguish between the moderates now and the bad guys, the jihadists, as the administration claims, but that's only because there are so many more jihadists with so much more power.
AB, with the exception of a few hawks like John McCain or Lindsey Graham, most members of Congress, both Republicans and Democrats, have not been eager to get more involved in Iraq and Syria. What do you think are the chances that they're going to support this president's program at this point to start arming the Syrian rebels?
Well, you're right. There's much disagreement about that and the levels of which we could get in and help them at this point, whether or not it would be effective. I think some help will be approved, but it's still going to be a big battle about specifics, and I don't know he'll get exactly what he wants. Just 4 weeks ago, when he announced the creation of this military training program, at the time it was reported that the Secretary of Defense, Chuck Hagel, had been concerned about whether or not we had a way to vet the moderate opposition and whether or not there were enough of them and there was enough time remaining where it would even make a difference. I think a lot of members of Congress feel that way.
You know, Charles, this is years and about 150,000 civilian deaths too late in terms of the Syrian civil war. What can a program like this do now? What can it accomplish both in terms of fighting Assad and also fighting the radical rebels, ISIS?
Oh, probably nothing, but it's worth a try because it's all we have. It's a three-sided war, as Steve says. We had a tremendous opportunity a year and a half, 2 years ago, to make a difference in the war before the influx of help by Hezbollah, by Russia, and by Iran turned the tide for Assad, who was reeling. Remember, there was the bombing in his own Security Council in Baghdad. There were stories that he had evacuated the family. That was the moment to strike, and the jihadists were much weaker. However, better to try now. The reason is, whatever the outcome is, if these guys are around, if there are any secularists left at the end, we want them to be our friends, our clients, people we know, whom we train. But the idea of waiting until next year is insane. There'll be nothing left by next year. It'll be ruling the rubble. And the idea of doing it in Jordan is probably the worst idea of all. Jordan is the one island of stability already inundated with refugees from Iraq and Syria. The last thing you want to do is to add to its instability and to make it a target. Do it in Turkey, do it in Eastern Europe, do it anywhere. But I think Jordan is the last place you want to jeopardize. That's the one gem in the region, and we got to hang on to it.
Steve, one of the questions is whether or not these rebels are going to go after Assad, as was their original intention, or will they go after ISIS? Do we know, in fact, that the moderate rebels will go after the more radical rebels?
No, not necessarily. I would expect that they would use much of the aid that we provide them to go after the Assad regime, which was their original enemy. And this is part of the problem. This is why this is such a cautionary tale, I think, for hardcore non-interventionists. I mean, what we might have been able to achieve, and look, this is always going to be messy, it was always going to be risky, but what we might have been able to achieve with small-scale, limited intervention in early and sort of critical time frame is now just a mess. I mean, this is a disaster over there, and the amount of U.S. Aid, the amount of U.S. engagement that this will take to really turn things around, I think, is almost incalculable. And again, it's not just Syria at this point. I mean, the president's now talking about aid to Syria. I mean, this is not just a Syria problem. This is a regional problem. We're talking about Iraq. We're talking about ISIS moving towards Baghdad in a way that resembles what we saw in Iraq, the sectarian strife we saw in Iraq in 2004 through 2007, when we had 150,000 U.S. troops, a huge diplomatic presence to turn this around.
Meanwhile, Iraq's main, most influential Shiite cleric, the Grand Ayatollah Ali Sistani, made a big announcement today. He called on the government to come up with a new prime minister before the parliament meets next Tuesday, which would seem to undercut the sitting prime minister, Nouri al-Maliki. Your thoughts about that, Charles?
Well, it's probably the most important event in the idea and in the attempt to change the government. It has to be changed. With Maliki, this can only be a sectarian war. Supporting the Maliki government will end up being supporting an Iranian, the client. Iran's already in there with al-Quds, with its reconnaissance, with all of its intelligence agents. The only way out of this, and everybody says it's so complicated, there is one truth in this. We were losing the war in Iraq when the Sunni tribes were against us. We won the war in Iraq when Petraeus changed the allegiance of the tribes. The region ISIS and al-Qaeda has returned is because the tribes once again changed and supported them because of the intolerance and the persecution of Maliki. Therefore, we have to see the government in Iraq change to get an inclusive one so that this is our only hope for rescuing this, so that we can once again regain the support of the tribes, which is doable. There have already been conflicts between the tribes, the local Iraqi tribes in Anbar, and ISIS. We have to exploit that and to win them back. If that's how Petraeus did it, that's the only way it'll succeed this time around.
Next up, the Friday Live.